everybody. Thank you everyone for being cooperative. We need to be on time because if we don't, we will be kicked out in the evening. So some of the programs will be cut off. So the next program we have is integration and empowerment of refugees and asylees in the Bay Area. And we have very fun, amazing panelists here who are actively engaged in the work of empowerment of refugee and asylee, and that also leads to integration. I will leave that for the moderator to tell you a lot about the panelists, but I want to say a few things about the moderator himself. A good friend of mine, a mentor to me, and someone that I look out to for all his work that he does, and I try to learn from his skills too. So Malcolm Cohen is a scholar, humanitarian, and philanthropist. He advises leaders nationally and internationally by providing strategies in an effort to create equitable social system, to create communities of belonging for all. His message is one of compassion, service, and action. Together we serve are the words that he lives by and wishes to inspire others. I know Malcolm in person, and he's been hardly working in Auckland and around Auckland to try to bring the shooting that we see on the streets, to try to bring black African men and women, and also the police department to work together and to work in conjunction so that we will have peaceful environment and then we will have no shooting on the streets. Here's a lot more than what I just read out, but I'm running out of time, and I will just welcome Malcolm Cohen.
And their challenges, you know, every day they're definitely real. In Cuba, I was in a village called Regla, in Havana. In Armenia, I was in Gimaru. And in the Dominican Republic, I got to support efforts in a village called Los Munos in Puerto Plata. And while in Armenia, I was fortunate to meet this young lady who was from Kuwait, whose family suffered tragic losses in the Syrian conflict. And in our exchange with one another, she looked at me and she hugged me and she said, "I'm really sorry." And I was like, "Well, why are you sorry?" She said, "Well, I'm really sorry for the genocide that's happening to your people in America." Now, that hit me. I was like, how would she know about this? Is this how the rest of the world is viewing America? And as she said it, it's real, it's true. And so, you know, what I'm seeing here, it hits on a deep level. And so what I'd like to encourage, especially for our students here in the audience, as you're hearing the presenters today, you know, definitely like write down questions, ask questions, figure out how you can get involved. For community members, if you're hearing individuals, if there's anybody that sparks your interest, reach out to them afterwards. Let's start networking, let's start building community with each other. For the staff and faculty that are here as well too, you hear something interesting, you see someone just sitting down, take the time to get to know one another and start to build community with each other. Because the world is really not that big. It's not that big. And for many of us in here, you know, they say if you have more than $15 in your pocket, then you're wealthier than 85% of the world. Like, that's real. And so as Marion is talking about, you know, contributing to causes like this, you know, we have to be able to financially support these so that we can continue to bring the awareness that's needed. And so I'm going to get off my soapbox for a second. And then I want to highlight the panelists that we have because these are our real leaders on the ground doing this real work every day and in most cases not receiving any breaks and very seldom a thank you, right? And so I want to acknowledge Blythe Raphael, and she serves as the coordinator for the East Bay Refugee Forum, a collaborator of over 30 agencies whose members work to address gaps in interagency knowledge and strengthen service provision in all areas pertaining to refugee resettlement. Blythe routinely interacts with staff in the fields of primary resettlement, legal, health, employment, education, and safety net benefits to ensure that refugees and asylees have proper access to services. Blythe trains and supports new refugee workers to learn safety net systems as well as how to professionally advocate for refugees, asylees, and other limited English proficient persons when the need arises. Next, we have Almaz Idego, has a master's degree in public administration from the California State East Bay, and currently seeking a PhD in the Global Health Program at UC Berkeley. She has over 10 years administrative experience working in non-for-profit organizations, government agencies, and community services. An active board member for several community agencies, serving diverse populations throughout the Bay Area, Ms. Idego has extensive professional and personal experience in mentoring and training families from diversified backgrounds in the successful navigation of the educational, health, and social service system. And she also is a very close personal friend of mine, and we serve together in Oakland. She's awesome. Next, we have Ms. Adiam Haile Rufiel. She is an Eritrean-American activist raising awareness in the areas of political and human rights issues in regard to Eritrea. Adiam is a founding member of Women for Change in Eritrea, which is a group of Eritrean-American women who volunteer to empower Eritrean-American communities in the United States of America, women, youth, and Eritrean refugees. Currently and locally, Adiam is the chairwoman of the newly founded Eritrean-American community of San Diego, California. And so, how we move forward with this, we will actually start off with Blythe. And then you'll have 20 minutes, and you'll pass it, down. We have our timekeeper, Brother Cebu, in the back. And so just keep an eye on him, and we'll stay very strict with the time. And we'll pass it up.
landscape looks like. We saw a lot of imagery and videos that were really quite horrible. But they're important images for us to see, and very, very important images, especially for service providers and trainers of service providers, such as myself, on a local level, so that the services that are being provided are in tune with the populations that are being served. The news that we see often on our daily evening local or international news does not feature stories in depth or give us the backgrounds of refugees that we see. Sometimes we see very short clips. I'm here today tasked with talking about challenges to integration on the local level. I serve as a coordinator of services for more than 5 years across the board in Alameda County, which is just across the bay in the East Bay, mainly in Oakland. I also serve as a feedback loop on the State Advisory Council for Refugees in the state of California in the public seat when there are issues that are being presented on the local level to be able to feed those up to the higher-ups in the administration. It's my pleasure to do the work that I do. I feel very, very grateful. I wanted to look at Bay Area refugees and asylees and the sort of general what the general challenges look like. If we're looking at the resettlement program overall in the United States, I am quite proud of this one thing about my country, and that is we do have a history of resettling refugees in our country. We are one of the largest resettlers of refugees in the world, actually, that will get and work with UNHCR to give people a home when they're fleeing persecution and have nowhere safe left to go. So that's one really nice feature about my country, our country, I should say. One of the biggest general challenges is that since 1980, refugee resettlement programs in the United States have been largely unchanged. So, 30 years period of time. These programs are really antiquated. They're in desperate need of a revamp. They have been for a very, very long time. The programs now, the funding does not account, and the program designs don't really account for the diversity of people that are being served under this large umbrella of refugee resettlement in the United States. We now are serving refugees, asylees, survivors of human trafficking, LGBT persons, unaccompanied minors, parolees. There are a very large and very diverse population of people being resettled from countries all over the world that have tremendous conflicts and resource wars that are going on. Back in the 1970s, things were a little bit more homogenous. That's not the case today. We have a political climate, as we all know, we have a presidential election coming. One tweet from last week that just shows how the political climate really is in relation to refugee resettlement sentiment in the United States is quite troubling. My teenage son came to me with his phone and he said, "I want you to see this. Last week on Monday, some of you may have seen, Donald Trump Jr. tweeted out with a graphic a white bowl, and inside the white bowl was a very well-known candy named Skittles. And at the very top of the tweet that Donald Trump Jr. sent said, "If I had a bowl of Skittles candy, and I told you that just three of these candies would kill you, would you take in a handful?" That's our Syrian refugee problem. You can take out the word Syrian and you can put Eritrean, Congolese, South Sudanese, any refugee group in the world. So that is the current political climate that we're operating in. So sometimes it's very, very difficult to watch. A lot of Americans don't have a good knowledge of the process of refugee resettlement in the United States. It's a very orderly process. We're seeing images from Europe where you have mass migrations of people. In the United States, it is very, very orderly. It is now an average that UNHCR says of 17 years that people will sit in a refugee camp waiting to be resettled into a third country. It's not by choice that people leave their home. Why would you do that? Why would you leave everything that you hold dear, your family ties, your family history, your networks, your culture? You are forced to go because of persecution. No one chooses to leave their home. There's a very, very intense vetting process that refugees and asylees go through before they reach the United States. It's posted on the State Department. It's an 8-series step. It's an average of 2 to 3 years to just simply pass through the vetting after you've been waiting for a very, very long time. So the process is very, very long time. I think a lot of people don't have an understanding of what the process looks like. We were talking about the numbers earlier. They say there are more refugees than there have been since the point in history, since after World War II. It's more than 65 million people right now. Less than 1% of the world's refugees actually ever make it out and get resettled into another country. That's just staggering. And those are the lucky ones. In our county, in Alameda County in the East Bay of San Francisco, we resettle approximately 1,000 refugees and asylees there every year. Probably the number is a little bit higher than that. We can't get adequate statistics. It sounds like a small amount, but in reality, if you parse out the calendar year, that's about one person per day walking through the office, just asylees alone in need of assistance. About a third of those 1,000 are actually Eritreans. This is the largest asylum community that we have in the East Bay right now, and the numbers from service provider informal word is that the numbers are on the uptick. So I think the panelists before did a really, really great job of looking at the conditions behind the migration that you're having from your own country. We look at the gross human rights abuses, forced conscriptions, and really, really the lack of the state institutions that you have in this autocracy. We have refugees now that are circumventing the globe. When those points are closed to them through Egypt or through Israel, through Europe if they're closed, we now have asylees from your country coming through the route that the professor showed us, all through South America, Central America, all the way up through Tijuana, and landing here in our local landscape as well. I can't imagine what a journey like that looks like. I think the point was made at the very beginning that we don't ever want to put a refugee or asylee in a box, but rather this is a real human being in front of you. And it's my job as a service provider and to train service providers to see and understand the background where people may be coming from, not to put them in a box, but to have some compassion and really understand what did it take to get here and what does life look like now. We have formal resettlement services. The asylees that are coming from Eritrea are not generally coming through the formal resettlement process. There are just a handful of them in the figures. Most countrymen from Eritrea are applying for asylum once they arrive here. I wanted to take a look at what the safety net looks at for asylees when they get here. After they apply for asylum and they're awaiting adjudication from the court, there is virtually no safety net at all. There are no government benefits allowed for asylees awaiting adjudication, with the exception lately of medical care, only in Alameda County, some other counties in California. What I'm seeing on the landscape, I know the conditions abroad are very, very difficult. On the local landscape, people are here, but the conditions still are very, very difficult. I'm seeing clients that are very marginally housed. They are couch surfing from house to house, sleeping on the floor, walking hours to appointments while they're waiting for their asylum cases to be heard. There's not two nickels in the pocket sometime of the clients that are walking through the door, walking hours to try and find someone to give them assistance to understand their paperwork or to make it to their legal court cases. There's almost no mental health support at all for refugees or asylees. It's not mandated by the government. The government does provide health screening. It includes a component, a mental health component, but there are almost no services available at all. Many clients do speak English. Many asylees from Eritrea do speak English. Many do not. This lack of sufficient English and being faced with all brand new systems, having to navigate and learn everything brand new, and the English language barriers really do present access issues to services. People don't know how to get medical care. They will forego medical care if they're afraid. They've heard from community members they're going to get hit with a heavy bill. They don't want to jeopardize their status in any way before they go to the court. They're going without because they are so scared. So this is how that looks like when we are trying to provide adequate services. I think it's always important to understand the background of the people. I do have many clients, many folks that are being served, asylees awaiting adjudication and post-adjudication that are actually in homeless shelters now. This is something new. I haven't seen this until the last maybe 3 years period of time. It may be because community members are in jeopardy for putting an extra person in their apartment and the landlord doesn't want to have another person in there and make the apartment over capacity. So we're finding folks in homeless shelters. Homeless shelters are not equipped to serve limited English proficient persons. Homeless shelter service providers don't know what a refugee is. They have no idea what an asylee is. There may be communication gaps and not services being provided because there are no interpreters available. So it is a difficult landscape for folks that are awaiting adjudication. The lucky ones that come through the resettlement agency, they get a support package. And this is what this has looked like since the really 1980s, with a very small adjustment of about $100. So if you're beginning your life brand new and the government said that you can come here as a refugee, you will get, as an individual, $1,225. Okay, that sounds okay, that's pretty cool. You know, $1,000, that sounds good. Well, let's talk about what you need to do with that money. You have to cover a first month's rent and a deposit on an apartment, and then all of your essentials. Talking about clients who sometimes come off of the airplane with shower shoes on and one t-shirt, maybe two changes of clothes, who've been so cold in the airplane that they're stuffing their feet, says the stewardess, in the front pockets of the airplane seat in front of them. They need to buy all these essentials. So $1,225 is for the lucky ones that actually come through the resettlement agencies. 95% of Eritreans coming into the Bay Area never ever receive any formal resettlement support at all. If you are an asylee or have been an asylee here, could you raise your hand if you were on your own? Were you on your own or did you have support? On your own. So majority of folks did not come through formal resettlement services. So that's the resettlement package for refugees. Also for refugees or people who have just been granted asylum, this is what life looks like. You think, wow, I've made it. I've got my asylum granted. I'm going to come in here. For a single refugee or asylee, the government gives you $365 per month, $190 in food, and you get medical insurance for those who are income qualified. Also, could you raise your hand if your rent or your mortgage is $365 or less? In the Bay Area, I need some connections. To have to survive here in the Bay Area on a package, $365 a month, is almost impossible. The stresses on your community members, on Eritreans and other asylum seekers, are absolutely immense. The safety net is the same for all impoverished Americans. And in Alameda County in the East Bay, refugees and asylees, they're vying for the same scarce resources that all other low-income Americans are vying for. And couple that with language barriers and insufficient knowledges of the service landscape. Once you're granted asylum here, you think, oh, service provider will think, oh, great, okay, now you're home free, right? I feel so relieved, phew! Once you're granted asylum, it's my experience in this community that the pressure is on even more than ever to support your family back at home. You have folks back at home that need to go to school, that maybe you're saving up, they have to be brought out of the country. The expectations are very, very high. And you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't, because if you do give the remittances, then some community members don't want the support going into the government. It's very, very difficult to be an Eritrean. Lots of daily stress for Eritreans before and after they get asylum. They're following on the phone, Facebook, and things, in-country conditions, and things that are going on back at home. They may not know the whereabouts of the ones that they hold dear. I have a client, current client right now, whose daughter is in one of the refugee camps that was featured, along with a few other family members. She was the first to come here. And her daughter leaves the camp once on a Sunday, walks more than 2 hours as a 15-year-old alone to phone her mom where the place is, where the cell phone reception is. Mom spends the rest of the week worrying, did my daughter get back safely? Will she phone me on Sunday? So lots of things always in the mind of Eritrean asylees. Another thing that is faced, we have this tremendous brain drain coming from your country, but there really are no formal pathways to re-credentialing people in the United States. So we've got engineers, you know, lawyers, doctors, nurses, that have no true pathway and are very underemployed. It's quite demoralizing, I think. You study, you do everything that you're supposed to do, and then you find yourself driving a taxi. One of the last biggest barriers, I think, to integration doesn't apply only to Eritreans, but it does to the whole refugee and asylee landscape in the Bay Area. We truly have no one-stop shop or no community-based gathering place for people to come and receive services that is neutral, where politics or the church are not involved, that people can come and concentrate on food, water, shelter, clothing, and medical care. We don't have that. We don't have a place for people to sit, come and sit down and have a cup of tea and just be a human being. When you're an asylee, a refugee, an asylee awaiting adjudication, you're going around town to appointments, on buses, stressed out, worried. You have these papers you're putting in front of people. You're always on the position of asking for something. It's very, very hard to be in the position where you are just always asking for something rather than being the contributor. And that is a very difficult position to be in. So when I have folks come into the office and I'm training new workers, I want them to be aware of the backgrounds of people that are standing in front of them, where they are in this point of life, maybe in their journey, and what does that look like, mapping their services, but also just understanding on a human level what that must look like at this point in time. Getting flash the 1 minute card. Public education on forced migration, I have to take my hat off to Mehran, who he fits in more in one day than 10 individuals, and the University of San Francisco. In all of the universities in this entire Bay Area, I have seen almost nothing, no conferences, nothing on forced migration. We see this on the news and clip, it's over there. Doesn't matter to us. It doesn't really affect us. Or we see these tweets from Donald Trump. Public education on forced migration and refugee issues is very, very important. So I really wanted to commend the university for taking on this topic. On an individual level, I train folks, and you will come across other people that are not only from your country, but maybe from other countries around the world. Never judge the book by its cover. You have no idea what the one person has been through. Over the last several years, I have had people tell me stories that seem so incredible that I just think there is no way that that person could have been pushed out of that window, that woman is a mail order bride, I'm being kept in a coffin before we hear about Abu Ghraib. People standing in front of me in Oakland telling me these things requires us to suspend disbelief, open our ears, and really treat people with the dignity that they deserve. I'm really quite amazed, I have to hand it to Eritreans, especially as one of the communities, you're quite egalitarian compared to many others. I see a lot of generosity, so much strength, it just blows me out of the water. And tremendous amount of resilience and grace. So on that note, I know all of you are very active in your community and you've given up your Saturday to come. Thank you for making your own communities stronger places. And we just really working to make sure that people can really achieve their full potential. As we started out with the moderator, he said something very, very important. When people don't feel as if they have a piece of the American pie, it's a very dangerous thing. We want everyone to feel that it's a just and inclusive society, whether that be African Americans or refugees or asylees. So on that note, thank you so much.
Next up, we have Almas.
Hey, my name is Almas. I think most of you know. The questions here says, what inspires you to serve the Eritrean community, and a little bit about yourself. You know, I'm an Eritrean immigrant myself. And what inspires me is like most Eritreans, you know, we love to help each other, we love to support each other, we struggle, and Eritrea have a major history that we struggle for many, many years, as even though now it's like, it's everywhere staggering, like people are suffering, we are a refugee, we are not as united as we used to be, but it's in my blood that makes me to be an Eritrean with, you know, always supporting other people. So I came from Sudan to America in 1997, and when I first came, I was struggling myself, like, you know, I don't know how to assimilate to this culture. When I see black people outside on the road, I used to try to speak to them in my language. It was so difficult, like, trying to relate to them, you know, it was difficult. And then started going to college, learning the culture and the system, and to just assimilate and be with this, with the American system. And then after that, I started college, and then I went to university, and then I started to associate with my own community, and then teach that what I know in my background, like the language that I know, the dance that I know, the culture that I know, and then teach my people. So I've been doing that for a long time and struggling with the system. To be immigrant is not, it's not easy. It's always a struggle. The day that you left your house, that's it. Your life is over. I'm gonna leave struggling, you know. There's nothing like home. So anyhow, I've been part of the Eritrean community even around 2005, 2004, like we've been teaching the Eritrean community to help them like with their tribal dance, language and all that stuff. It was difficult because the Eritrean refugees, they came here before, was not really supportive to the young generation as much as we want to help. So anyway, it was a lot of struggle, and then keep going after that. I started also helping immigrants, like with their paperwork, asylum applications, green card applications, even most of them, a lot of them were stayed with me also because they don't have any family members to support them. And then some of them also coming from outside of the Bay Area, so because they think Bay Area is the better place to do asylum. So anyhow, with that, I've been really helping a lot of people myself, individually. And then after I finish school, after I did my master's, I say like maybe I should have a consulting license so I can help in the medical fields, in the asylum areas, I mean immigration fields, and other education areas, and associate with my community, and I can start working. It's not really that easy. As I mentioned, I'm going to mention it again and again, but the community are not really supportive when it comes to progressive things like in terms of education, in terms of asylum, in terms of we don't have that organizations that help us really well, that we can say, okay, this is the Eritrean community, that somebody is going to help you fill in up a asylum case or filling up applications with social service, or filling up like going to school, okay, which school do you go to, which public school is better. How do you, you know, there's nothing like that. There's no structure, even though we have, as my colleague here mentions, that we are very humble, we're very supportive, and very, you know, stubborn to get what we want to help our family back home, but here we don't have no structure. So with that, I've been helping a lot of people. I helped a lady that she's been here 18 years without status in America. 18 years, she came from Eritrea. She's 60 years old, woman walking around. Somebody takes advantage of her money and then she doesn't know what to do. So I've been doing this and working with immigrants for a long time. And I don't know what to exactly say, but it's so difficult for us. We need to have structure. And then right now, with this reason, we are starting to navigate with a group of people like from Africa, like Mervin is one of them, Eden here, UL is here. I'm not gonna take too much of your time, but we try to navigate how to help immigrants, you know, without difficulty, to help them to fill their paperwork when they came here to this country, to help them fill out their paperwork, fill out their asylum cases, help them when somebody can help them going to the immigration office, to the asylum, and then translate for them. Because there's a lot of issues, even in the hospitals and the immigrations everywhere. And that's what we're doing. And also, like there is, like she mentioned, there's people coming with a lot of traumas. Traumas that you've seen it already, Dr. Alganish showed it, showed it, how and Joe and Johannes already show you in the video how they struggle coming, crossing the borders, coming here. And then when they come here, there's a lot of trauma. Because if you categorize the immigrants that they came here years and years ago, people like Dr. Dabas and the people, the camps of years, 20 years or 30 years, they don't have that issue. They came here to learn. Or maybe they came for school also, their family sent them. They came here with a scholarship. And then after that, when I came, it was not even that difficult, but now what they're going through on the road to cross the camp to the United States is completely out of question. It's very, very, very difficult. So when the immigrants that they came years and years ago and the immigrants now are completely different and their perspective or when they came here, they, even the way they communicate with you, even their humbleness and their feeling is completely different. So what I see from them is they are, since they passed all this trauma, there is no structure here to support them first financially and with their asylum cases, with their financial issues, and all that, and getting jobs, getting education, and all that. And in addition to that, they also have issues, mental issues. They have a lot of traumas. The traumas they go through, there's nothing you can, there's not no system to support them, or no Eritrean community and here structuring to say, okay, these people are going through hell, so how do we help them? How do we help them to calm down? How do we help them financially? How do we help them to get housing and other stuff? So there's nothing like that. So I go through, I see a lot of differences right now, and then that's the reason why we, as Eritreans, we need to really, really pay attention and then start something together that how we're gonna help the immigrants that come in here, their traumas, their financial issues, their education issues, all this kind of stuff. It's not nothing, no system at all, no system here to support us as the new immigrants are coming. So I'm not gonna go back and address all these issues already addressed, how they're coming, where they're coming, how many refugees we have, what kind of issues we have in our country. All this is already, each and everybody knows here. So how do we support them when they came here? That I see with the elderly, also with the family members. Family members coming from Eritrea, young children also coming here. At the public school in the United States, like in Oakland or in the Bay Area, is also not friendly to immigrants. Because immigrants came here, they try to put their kids to school, to the public school. When they go to the public school, they put them, okay, they don't know how to speak English, but they put them in third grade, fourth grade, fifth grade. So these people, they just go to the class and sit in the class and come home. They don't learn nothing, you know? It's gonna, eventually their kids, they're gonna learn the language, and they will catch up somehow, but they're going through traumas, even in the young age. So I see that, I observe that from my, you know, from the experience of the community that I help, the young children that I help, the family that I help. So with that, they just go to the school and come home. And there's no system, the same thing, there's no system, the Eritrean community, to help these people translate, I mean, transfer from the Eritrean language that they, you know, to the English language, to learn and then learn math, learn English, learn the how to assimilate with the American culture, how to communicate with the American people or other people on school. So that is the other issues that we're going through. So with this all, we have a global communication services that we are already incorporate together. Our collectives are Melvin is right here. He works with me, and then Eden up by UL, and we have all different people, Americans and Africans, that so we can navigate. We can navigate as all these areas that I mentioned. How do we help asylum cases that fill up their papers, they don't have money, we can help them how to go to the hospital and translate for them. And then how do we help a young children that come into United States and then to fit with the American school. And then that's what we're working on. We're working on that. And how to, as she mentions, the Eritreans coming from Eritrea, some of them are engineers, some of them are, you know, teachers, some of them are nurses, some of them are lawyers. They have skills like that, but they don't know how to fit with the system. And they came here and they drive taxis, most of them, driving taxi, driving trucks, driving. We have to help them to transfer from that profession to other professions also, like, you know, help them to navigate the system so they can transfer to other professions. They're doing that, and then to survive, immigrant when they come here, is all they care about is survival. How do we survive? How do we help our family? How do we help? You've seen it already in the video. You know, there's a lot of people need help back home. How do we help this family? So they came here and they tried to help their family. They don't even think about themselves. And it was all the traumas they came through. So for with me and my group, my collective groups, we're trying to also navigate how to, we train them professionally, like how do they apply for jobs, how do they get their resumes, how do they get interview, what kind of jobs can we help them to navigate according to their backgrounds. And we also doing that kind of stuff. So this is what we're doing. And I'm not going to bore you a lot because it's all already been said. And if you have any questions, you can ask me. But that's what we're doing right now.
And next we have Adi.
Good morning, everyone. How are you doing? Melvin, thank you for the introduction. Don't count my time yet, I haven't started. He made a good point. We're watching North Carolina and Ferguson and everything that's going on, and it's not a black cause, it's not an African American cause. It is a human issue and it is injustice. So we do need to shed light on that today. A lot of my friends will talk to me about it because they hear my English, and some may know that, oh, she's from Eritrea, or she, you know, where's she from? We know she's from Africa. But because of my English, you know, they just assume that I'm African American, and we discuss it. And then they know that I'm really truly dedicated to the Eritrean cause right now, but I wanna say that our hearts and our solidarity are here too, because we do live here at the end of the day. You know, we are American at the end of the day. So I just want to give you a shout out for that. Thank you. All right. When Medon called me about the conference, I was really excited because Medon is young and he's dedicated and he is persistent and he wants to do something just like I want to do something. What the audience is going to be like, I kept asking him because I didn't know how to write the speech. I didn't know if I should do it in Tigrinya, like I could speak the best Tigrinya, but I just kind of wrote about who I am as an activist and my role. We heard a lot from Dr. Al-Gainish and Dan Connell and our other brother, and they gave a great background and foundation to Eritrea and the current state of Eritrea. So I'm just gonna kind of take it from there. I don't think it's necessary for me to reiterate. I'm honored to be amongst a dynamic group of individuals today and an audience that has decided to spend their Saturday here with us at this conference. I want to thank Medon Harway, for my brother, for working hard to bring us all together for the conference on Eritrea, 25 years, human rights, migration, democracy. Medon's determination to have this conference on Eritrea and working hard to organize and bring this all together is awesome. And a great first step in creating open dialogue in regards to Eritrea on an academic level, with a diverse group of speakers. So I salute Medon and members of the University of San Francisco staff who also assisted in making today's conference happen. Before I move forward, since this is about Eritrea, I also really would like to give credit and salute and just kind of, I told her, do this to Dr. Al-Gainish Fasai for everything that she's doing. As a young Eritrean-American woman, when I started in the Movement for Democratic Change, I was met with a lot of opposition. Opposition meaning from my fellow Eritrean women, sisters, who said, no, you're young, what had I told anybody? That means you don't know nothing. You're just going off what you hear. So when I met Dr. Al-Gainish and saw her work, I was truly inspired and motivated, and I knew that I wasn't young, and I wasn't just, you know, soile, I'm not. And when she came back in 2013 in Washington, D.C., and showed us the videos that she showed you today, and showed us all the suffering that was going on to Eritrean people, I said, thank you, God, because we're not alone, and we do have one. So Dr. Al-Gainish, please stand up. I really want all of us. Thank you. I'm an Eritrean-American that was born and raised in the diaspora, and I spent the majority of my life in San Diego, California, where I was raised since the age of two. Both my parents were born in Eritrea, and ever since I was a child, they would always teach me and my younger brother about Eritrea, our roots, and the importance of knowing our heritage and not forgetting where we come from. My mother and father left Eritrea in the late 70s. As you all know, when Gusto was in power, Dirk, I wasn't even born yet, they escaped. My father was an advocate and a member of EPLF, Eritrean People's Liberation Front. Dan Connell did give background on that to the Americans in our audience. He wasn't a Tagada alive, but he was a member, and he instilled that in me and my brother when we were born. Everything was about Zwakumbad, everything was about EPLF, everything was about Sharia, and my friends as well. So growing up in San Diego, we had a phenomenal Eritrean community. We attended Tigrinya school on the weekends, and Tigrinya is the national language spoken in Eritrea, but there is also Arabic, which is spoken there. Tigrinya school is a time for all Eritrean American kids to learn our native language, learn about our new nation, Eritrea, obviously in the 90s, and our culture, be mega connected with other Eritrean American kids. By the time I attended high school and college, I was deeply involved in the Eritrean community, volunteering in any way I can, going beyond my hometown of San Diego and working with other Eritrean communities in other cities in the United States. I would travel to Los Angeles, Dallas, everywhere, just working with different Eritrean communities and kids, teaching them dance, Tigrinya dance, hip hop. I was just all about anything that had to do with our community. Within this time frame of my years growing up and making my way into college, my Eritreanism was at an all-time high. Eritreanism is a word that I use to describe my patriotism to my Eritrean heritage that I felt deep within my soul. Although I was living my life here in America, my connection to the Eritrean culture and the community was a huge part of my makeup. And as Adia, I said to myself, I'll do everything to volunteer for my community and maybe even go back home one day and serve and volunteer. After I graduated from high school and began to attend college, I attended the University of California, Riverside, where I majored in political science. I began to think maybe I can go to Eritrea, and I was thinking, how can I do that? So I began my journey through college, and as I was doing that, I also had questions, and I was challenging my parents, my father in particular, about one issue that bothered me from my senior year on, and a question that I was wondering about, and I said to him, listen, when will there be presidential elections in Eritrea? And he looked at me, and then I even tried to ask community members, they just looked at me, they don't want to say anything. But my father, he's my father, he's very outspoken, he said, we do have a leader, mind you, he didn't say president. He said, we do have a leader. His name is Isa Asafoki. And I replied, but when was their presidential election? Like, did I miss it? I don't remember, you know? And he said, soon, when there will be elections, and then he said, Ademina Guare, Eritrea is a new nation, and things take time. You have to be patient. So since I was a teenager at the time, many of my political questions for my father and the Eritrean community about conducting elections in Eritrea and implementing a constitution and overall implementing democratic values and principles in the nation of Eritrea were not just simple questions that I had. They were serious and sincere concerns from my motherland. I was young and a bit naive, but I wanted Eritrea to be exactly like the country I grew up here in America. I wanted it to be a democratic nation. I was ready. You know, I was ready to be a part of all of that and see it happen. After I graduated UC Riverside, I moved back to my hometown of San Diego. And in 2009, I began to meet many Eritrean refugees who were crossing the border through Mexico. Just as Blythe here stated and our speakers earlier. And many who told me they escaped Eritrea and walked here to the United States. I didn't understand what was going on. I was lost. That's what you mean. Like, I'm like, what do you mean you walked here? What does that mean? And this guy says, which means I came by feet, literally. But he said, I came through Mexico, which is 30 minutes away from where I live in San Diego, the border. So I asked this guy, I met this guy, his name was Jaime, and I'll try to keep this story very short. He was at my store, my parents had a family business. He came to buy water. I couldn't tell if he was Pakistani or what. But then he said, Salam Kamalahi, which is hello, how are you? And I said, oh, hi. And I said, you speak Tigrinya? And he said, yes. And he asked me then if I was Eritrean, and I said, yes, I am. My name is Adam. And then he said, my name is Haile. And I said, nice to meet you. And I said, what are you doing here? Do you have family? And he's like, no, I don't have anybody. I'm just here. I just came here. And again, you guys have to understand, I'm a college graduate. In my mind, Eritrea does have issues. We were learning about the G15, the closing down of University of Asmara. All these things were taking place. But the aspect of refugees coming here through Mexico, that was something that I didn't know anything about. So I told him, why don't you come back next time we can sit and talk? And he said, okay. He was wearing clothes, like you said, it just didn't fit him. It looked like he was wearing his dad's clothes. He was in his 30s, but he weighed maybe like 80 or 90 pounds. So I just was kind of confused. So he came back the following week, and he told me, situation back home is not good. And I said, Taiwan is cut, which means, what does that mean? He said, nothing, it's just not good. So I didn't want to keep pushing him, because I could tell he's been through a lot. And he would come to the store every week. He would tell me jokes in Tigrinya. We would laugh. He loved art. He was just a nice guy, you know? And I was innocent at that time, not knowing who he was, what his struggle was, or what was really going on in Eritrea. One day, I asked him a question about Eritrea, and he just said to me, Ademina, I know you love your nation, Eritrea, and Tigrinya, and you're a very Hagrawian. Hagrawian means like proud, patriotic, and you should be, but you should know that everything's not always what it seems. And the youth back home in Eritrea, they're going through a lot, and that's all I can say to you. And I said, wait, you know, I was trying to probe him for more information. He said, I don't want to say too much. And I said to him, Haile, this is America. You are free to say what you want and express yourself. It's okay, don't be scared. However, it was obvious that Haile had faced much trauma and suffered, and he would never, ever feel free. Even though he was here with me at that coffee shop, and he was in a country with freedoms, the impact of growing up in Eritrea under repression just traumatized him to the core. It didn't even matter. He was just psychologically messed up. But again, I didn't know why. So after a couple weeks, Haile, you know, he didn't come visit me. We would visit like once a week, like I told you guys, for like 2 months, and then he didn't come, I missed him. And then I got kind of worried. And then I asked my dad, I said, Baba, have you heard about that guy, Haile? He said, no, I haven't heard anything, but he's probably just busy. Then I heard from him once, he got a part-time job, dare you, after that, a few. Like, he just disappeared. So my stomach begins to hurt. You know, you get that feeling, like something's not right. So I asked around and people said they don't really know him. And then finally about a couple weeks later, my dad came to the store and I was leaving and he says to me, sit down, Kofbeli. And I said, what is it? And he's just like, Zagwa de Haile Moy too, you know? Seriously. And I'm not trying to be like sad. What we saw on the video was sad. You know what I'm saying? Like, people are dying. But this brother came all the way through Mexico, and he was dead for like 7 days in the house in a pool of blood, and nobody knew who he was, you know? And I just screamed, like I was in the store screaming, like, what? Like, what happened? He's like, Ajohe, you know? So we had a funeral, it was short. It was 2008 or 9, it's been so long. It feels like a dream. When I talk about this guy, I don't know his last name, you guys. I don't even really remember what he looks like. But it's like he's an angel that came to me in my life.
And ever since then, in 2010, I got involved in the Movement for Democratic Change. I met more Eritreans coming through the border because I live in San Diego, you know? And they were telling me everything, what they were going through about Sawa. Here we thought Sawa was just like serving your nation, giving back. But it's not a slave labor. I decided to join the movement and I learned a lot. And I met a lot of good people. I met a lot of brothers here in the Bay Area, like Al Solomon, you know, and other guys that really motivated me and inspired me. And in 2011, when I began to study more and talk to more refugees, I heard about Isaias Afwerki coming to New York, you know? And he was there to give a speech. Isaias is the leader of Eritrea right now. Some people call him a president, that's fine to me, he's a dictator. And he was there to give a speech, and there were thousands and thousands of Eritreans there to support him, and only like 10 or 20 in the morning, 10 of us. And I saw all of these people, and I said, why are they here? And they said, well, Nurumet's here, they came to see him. And we spent the whole day demonstrating, you know? And that was the first time, at least here in America, that there were a group of young people, kids, that decided to oppose and decided not to just join because everybody's doing it. And we found out that an audience member asked Isaias, what do you think about those kids outside demonstrating against you? And he said to them in Tigrinya, I'm a Messini. So that basically means once you take the trash outside of your home, you don't bring it back. And you know what? I was so happy that he said that and he called us trash, because I felt like, you know what? He's acknowledging that there's an opposition. They've never acknowledged that anybody or any entity opposes them. They always felt like if we ignore it, if they gave it a blind eye, then he had no one. But at that moment in time, he acknowledged that we exist. And that meant a lot to me as an activist. Following the demonstration in New York, we created Women for Change in Eritrea, which is we created on Facebook, me and another young woman. And after that, more girls followed. And by the time this 5-6 years have passed, you've seen a lot of girls now in Europe, everywhere. Everyone is very strong and confident, and it's not what it used to be. Our movement was just a small group, and prior to that, just a bunch of older men. But now it's diversified, and people now feel like they are empowered to say something. And Women for Change in Eritrea is a group of women from all backgrounds, not just Eritrean women, who empower, you know, youth, communities here in America, and refugees, not to be as scared as like Haile was, you know? Let them know that you can say what you want, you're here in America, you know, you're free. Another thing that I wanted to talk to you guys about is the community. The community I grew up with in San Diego is about a 30-year-old community. And now many people tell me, oh, Ariam, your community was really ran by EPLF, right? And you know, it's more of a political community. And I said to them, for whatever it was worth, it made me who I am today. And all we can do is create new communities that are non-political, non-religious. So my journey in the Movement for Democratic Change, one thing it taught me is, like Alma said, we need communities. We need our communities and we need to take them back. Those communities do not belong to one political party, to one Auraja meaning ethnic group, or Haimanot. Eritrean communities should belong to everybody. So even though I'm traveling and demonstrating, one thing I told my mind was, we need community. So I got with a group of brothers in San Diego. They're a little bit older than me, but they all are either accountants, engineers, or lawyers. They said, Adam, Hena, we cannot meet the life of hate like you. They were honest. You know, they have families. They'll help in any way they can. The life of hate means change seeker. But we can help you with this community. So we are working on the 501c3. We just got an office. And now we have something for our people. Now we have something for refugees. We just bought a mogogo, which is an injera maker, for this woman who just came from Chinalba with her 5 kids. You know, because they couldn't eat the food. You know, I bought them pizza. They looked at the pizza like it wasn't food. They were like, injera delima, izi magbiya konen, you know? So we're finally offering services in San Diego, and we're there for everyone. The older community, the community I grew up with, the board members, they're my dads. Many, some of them are members of PFDJ of Hate Deaf, some of them are not, kind of what they call langa langa. Langa langa tibinya means like, you don't really know where you're at, you know, for English speakers, just kind of confused. So, but I love them and they love me. And then they said, we know what you're trying to do, we understand it. So that means they said to me, we understand what you're trying to do and one day we will be united, we will be together. But as of right now, we do have two communities in San Diego. One is the Eritrean community and the one that I founded with, along with a group of great people from my father's generation as well who are open-minded is the Eritrean-American community of San Diego. And in 2016, we're starting from scratch. That's the sad part about Eritrea. All that sacrifice, all the struggle and everything that it's taking my generation to start from A all over again. I mean, is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? It just depends. It's a matter of perspective. The way I see it is, we're running out of time and we have to do it. We have to act. And in Las Vegas, they have opened the Eritrean American community of Las Vegas. In Dallas, they've opened the Eritrean American community of Dallas. And we're trying to open these communities everywhere. That way we have independent entities that belong to the people, for the people, by the people. It's been 6 years since I decided to be a voice in regards to Eritrea, and during my journey it has been an uphill battle. However, through platforms like today's conference where we can have open dialogue and communicate genuinely, we can begin to find solutions and constructively build a united and democratic Eritrea. I am a descendant of Eritrea, and my bond to my roots will never be broken. Yet there are also many other non-Eritreans that have dedicated much of their time and studies in their lives towards Eritrea, and we must recognize their work and dedication equally as we do to one another. Dr. Hepner, who's here, who's a professor of anthropology, Dan Connell, who's an author and he's just everything, you know, who's dedicated his life in every kind of way. These people are not Eritrean, but it doesn't matter. You know, they're human beings who are dedicated to Eritrea and honorary Eritreans in my mind, you know? So I do want to acknowledge them. And John Stafford, who's not here today. And many more individuals who at the end of the day share a common factor with us as Eritreans, and that is the best interest in our nation, interest and the Eritrean people. It will take tolerance and an inclusive village to build a democratic and prosperous nation, and the village we have here today is diverse, as we can see on stage and in the audience, as we commemorate Eritrea after 25 years. We do have a lot of work ahead of us, but united we can do all things, and hopefully soon, our next commemoration of Eritrean independence will be held at the University of Asmara, maybe, you never know. And before I end, I want to add two things. I'm still a girl, I'm a woman, and sometimes I have forgotten that in my journey as being in the life of me. My birthday was yesterday, completely forgot. It took my family to remind me. And I'm gonna get married in 2 weeks. But you know what they say, she's gonna get married. You know, I'm not there mentally because I'm so into this. My heart weighs heavy because I get to celebrate my birthdays and I'm gonna get married. When we see the mother who drowned in Lampedusa giving birth, you know? So all those images and everything that we're doing, I feel guilty, to be honest with you. I'm blessed, but it's bittersweet. And I feel like my people are dying and my people are suffering and they're struggling. And I know I have to continue on with my life, but it's hard. It's really, really difficult and it's challenging. But I think that if we as Eritreans, especially right now, I'm talking to my Eritrean brothers and sisters, if we come together and put aside all of our differences, it doesn't matter, religion, Araja, all of that, everything people that are fighting over, we can bring change. We just have to come together, we have to unite. And I always tell all the abetis, the older generation, it's not about you guys, it's not about what happened in the past, it's not about ELF or EPLF, Jabha Sha'abiyah, it's about the future Eritrea. We have to start talking about Eritrea. And these are the things that weigh heavy as I'm looking towards a new future for myself, so thank you.
Thank you so much, Adi. That was powerful. section right now. And so, who has a question that they would like to address at the panel? And whoever does, Sabu will run. He's running right now. He's going.
My question is for any of you. Can you guys hear me?
No.
So, about mental health issues, I wanted to address that, the psychosocial issues that come with being a refugee and asylum. What is it like? I mean, have you guys had any experience holding a vigil, a memorial, or like a community healing circle? Because I wanted to take that into consideration maybe this year, next year, whenever the time comes, because I see how unorganized it could be. When I am walking down the streets, I have seen plenty of visuals, plenty of memorials, one being for the Eritreans and the Lampedusa, of Lampedusa drowning in 2012-2013. However, we're going on a hiatus now in terms of like reaching our goals, our health goals as a community to address the issues that happen to be very pervasive on the mental and, I guess, mental level and individual level. So, any ideas?
I'll hand it over to Blake.
Okay.
I'm going to go back to, we don't have a good community, like you were saying, but we need to have a community. And if there are people in our community who major in psychology, mental health, and all those issues, to volunteer. You know, it's just, it's going down to like only a few people are doing the work. So in my opinion, we need volunteers. We need people to volunteer in those aspects. But like, maybe you can,
Yeah, I just want to say also, like Eden has been focusing on that too. And then we have people in our collectives that they can volunteer with mental health, that we just have to really come into find out how we can do it with the Eritreans, especially like maybe we just have to sit down, talk, and then they can talk how they came through. Because this is the trauma that they came through about our people also, they keep it to themselves. So they just get isolated, and then the depression, the way they came through, and then when they come here, immigration issues, and then financial issues, and all that stuff. So we can create a circle under our program as well, and then also, as everybody here, there's most of you are leaders, like Solomon, Johannes, and all of us, we can discuss, communicate, and then see, navigate how we're gonna do it. And we have a qualified people to do the mental health or counseling or sit down in a circle and talk. But if there's another way that she knows, she can also tell us about it.
Mental health is always a difficult question to answer. I don't think that there are ever enough trauma-informed services throughout the entire United States. Some cities are more fortunate than others in that they do have trauma-informed care for refugee populations or trauma survivors. San Francisco has Survivors International. Oakland itself has had nothing on the landscape save the Human Rights Clinic. Many of you may have gone through there. We have many asylees awaiting adjudication that go for forensic medical evaluations there to document the tortures that were committed against them. Other than that, it's my experience that new arrival refugees are so busy with the very, very grind of trying to survive and to navigate all these brand new things. Life looks very, very different if you don't speak English or you don't know ABCs in your own language. You are memorizing everything. You are so stressed out about learning how to use the bus, financially constrained. Your own healthcare, to my estimation, is always the next thing after the very last. And we do, unfortunately, have very, very serious mental health needs. We have a new partner on the scene locally, but I think as a whole, the United States would do very, very well to examine the whole refugee resettlement and asylee services package and put some essential funding into services that are not only individual based for people that are really seriously in need or in crisis, but also for wellness activities that may be more culturally appropriate, whether that be cooking or dancing or doing things that the community would recognize. I organized a crisis training for suicide prevention geared toward a different refugee group. Within the first 30 minutes of that training, there was a refugee. I thought, how does this person in the training, this is for service providers, this man of a family of five had been here for less than 3 months, was sitting there. He came to that meeting as his only avenue of trying to get help and said, I can easily see why it is people are driven to suicide. It's their last option when they feel they have nothing else. And he held up the eviction notice, and then the tears come. We do have compelling health behavioral needs. I think the government itself needs to put funding at the top. We do have some service providers, but again, I think those services are very siloed into different hospitals or communities. And it's not necessarily that, even if people know it exists, they may have access issues to actually getting the care they need. Many times, telephone today, you have to pass the telephone prompt, dial one, you can talk to the nurse and get an appointment. There's no walk-in capability. Refugees and asylees, they don't understand the healthcare model here. It's not geared toward their service provision. Last week, health insurance technician phone says, I have an Eritrean here in the office. He's causing quite a stir. And why is that? Service provider's getting upset. He's very agitated. They asked him again and again, if you want us to fill you a Medi-Cal application, you need this healthcare desperately. We need your passport. And she said to me, explain to me why he doesn't have the passport. Like everyone else we've seen in the last 3 years making these applications. And I said, ask him, did he walk here? Did he come through Mexico? She herself is from Mexico. She said, Mexico? An Eritrean coming through Mexico? I said, yes, this is the new theme that you're going to start seeing. The community member was tenacious enough that he said, no, I only want to see her, she's going to serve me. And she said, he wasn't leaving. And she said, as a service provider, it's really important, like the education that you're giving us today, what the backgrounds are and how people are coming into services. So I think that's a very long answer. I think it's probably time for lunch in the back.
I just want to add one thing. There have been increasing Eritrean trauma situation in the Bay Area, and I came across an email that was forwarded by John Stafford, which Adia mentioned. And the issue is right here in our neighbor, Santa Rosa. So what the social services have been facing is that they've been seeing an increasing number of Eritrean trauma, people with trauma, and they didn't know how to face it. And the next thing that they've been asking is like, what do we do? Or Eritrean organization that's dealing with such kind of situation. And they couldn't come across any. What they did was they contacted John Stafford, who have an organization called Eritrean Refugee. And what he does is he tries to help with resettlement. He doesn't deal with those things. So it's for us here Eritreans, if we could do something about trauma. In my own way, I tried to connect them with an Eritrean who is specializing in trauma. But again, also, if we are close to those social services, wherever we are, if we can educate them about the culture, the tradition, the religion, and also the root cause, why those people are fleeing the country, and where the trauma is coming from. If we could at least tell them those things from wherever we are, and that would help them to craft a better way to resolve the trauma that Eritreans are facing coming to their doors. I just want to add that. Thank you.
And so I want to try to see if I can put kind of like everyone's comments together and kind of add something in there as well too. Adim, I think that you were right on the money in terms of building community, right? Because once we're able to all come together, right, then we can talk about real issues. But then what also happens is the government sees it, right? When enough people come together and they speak, imagine if you were able to have 25 to 50 Eritreans go into a city council meeting saying, hey, what's going on? Why is our language not represented in the literature for the city? Something that all of us and I realized when we were speaking at the Eritrean Orthodox Community Church in Oakland is that we had a number of people that were in there that weren't quite sure if they were registered to vote or not. But then when we looked on the voter registration website for Alameda County, we saw, what did we see? We saw Tagalog that was represented. We saw Spanish that was represented. Cantonese that was represented, right? But as far as like Tigrinya or Amharic, it was not represented at all. And so when the city is sitting out literature for what the city is going to do, the changes that it's going to make, when they're trying to decide, you know, where certain budget allocations are going to go, or what are we going to invest money in, if they don't know you exist, they're not even thinking about you. You're not even on their minds. And so it's like, okay, what do we do to get ourselves, you know, on the table? And so that's something that she's fighting for in Oakland right now, is to get Eritreans represented and to get the language represented, because there's a populace that's there that needs to be supported. And I think to Blythe's point is absolutely correct. You know, the moment that folks come here to America, you're given very minimal resources and expected to make it, right? But in the Bay Area, it's really hard to survive. Housing is an issue. Securing job opportunities, that's an issue. Health is an issue. Trying to understand and navigate that system. And if the system really doesn't understand your culture or your language, then it's hard. It's really hard to navigate that. And so many of our people, they get lost in that process. And so by being able to come together, to have that voice, even having the leaders represented, coming to the table and fighting to even get the language represented and the language to be acknowledged, that's one major step in moving forward. We have to be a part of that democratic process. We have to. And so, and America is founded on that. And so I just wanted to put that piece out there, because when we have it, when our voices are represented, we're heard, right? And so you had a question.
No, actually, I would like to add to the main topic of the game, because through the ECR City Forum in life, I came to know that the chat for health for Asian Americans gave training to two Eritrean leaders about mental health and community leadership that ran through for 1 year. And we already graduated to members, and we are in the next phase of their projects. So I would really like to thank Lies. It has been a lot to our community. We still have. But I would love, you know, if he can take people here, all the things that one that she did to the girl, he wants to. That's really nice. I would love you, those people. We know about this woman that was about to be evicted, and we supported her.
I think I might touch that one that got me into a little bit of a tight spot there.
What you did for that, God bless you in behalf of our people.
I think it's really important as community members that the more that you share the knowledge and the resources, then each person isn't feeling on their own to reinvent or to find the information or the connections that they need. The knowledge is power. Even if you have finite resources, if you're sharing those in a transparent way, we do that across the agency boards to try to make knowledge resources available to everyone instead of just a few larger agencies with a lot of political clout or a lot of money hogging all of those things, to really disseminate information across the board so that the smaller community-based organizations are able to equally access those resources. So we try with the existing resources to put together a safety net plan. Our county is also very unique. It took 3 years of lobbying to get two part-time workers on a grant to help people navigate. The workers were hired on greatest language need, so we now have a part-time Eritrean worker and another part-time worker, just to help people connect those systems. That's 3 years worth of lobbying and a very small bit of funding. But together, I think you all make the collective impact. one person alone can't do it, but collectively, it's very, very powerful.
Do we have any questions? Oh, we have one in the back. Right.
Thank you guys for putting this together. My statement might not be directly a question, but maybe reflecting where Eritreans are, where we are, in terms of organizing and helping each other and transitioning and figuring out where do we go from here. I think we are all activists, that's why we are here. All these Eritreans that are here are working individually in their own community, in their own life, but I think what we are lacking is organization, centralizing all this energy instead of me helping two people, somebody helping 10 people. We need to centralize our energy and use our club, like you mentioned, and talk to each other. Because when you speak, when you talk, when you voice your concern, you find a solution. But I have ideas, but nobody knows them because I'm not there. But if we all gather together, make sure that we communicate our concerns and other people's concerns, and we together can find a solution. So how do we organize? How I am willing to participate, but how do we organize all the activists, all the Eritreans with concern, everyone that are working by themselves? Put them together and use that, harness that energy and move forward. So I think every Eritrean that is here today, we need to commit, we need to organize ourselves, and we need to contact, communicate with each other so we can use the momentum to figure out where the solution lies. Thank you.
What was your name?
Nebia
Hafte. That's a very good point. And I think that today is a good example. Like, Medon doing this independently is a start. I told you that we do have a group, Women for Change. It's just an association, it's like a mahaba. And we're independent, meaning that we do something, but on a smaller level. So eventually, we do all have to come together. And it's gonna take the new generation to do that. I love our the older generation, and I love our parents, but it has come time for Meron, myself, you, Almaz, and others to take the forefront.
Yeah.
Last year, we organized a demonstration in New York City. 3,000 Eritreans came, and friends of Eritreans came. It was successful. Why? Because the new generation, with the support of the older generation, made it happen. It was inclusive, and it was tolerant. There is a struggle going on, and the struggle is between the old and the new. I'll tell you that much. That's number one. That can be in any political realm, maybe even here in the States. But Abana, in our society right now, the old does not want to let go. They don't want to let go. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna try our best to be respectful, okay, and work with them and communicate with them. And in sometimes, like some situations this year, I have decided to bow out respectfully and say, okay, that's fine, to go on ahead and do it. But moving forward, we're not gonna stop. I'm not gonna stop. By the power, you know, that we have as a people and God, I think that we're very capable. Not just the new generation, but women. We have Dr. Al-Ghanish, we have Trisha, we have Unebia, we have Almaz, we have Light. There's a lot of strong women in this room. So I believe through more involvement of women, youth, young adults, and the new generation, we can do what you said. It's just gonna take a little bit of time, and it's gonna take a platform like this for us to meet, but it will happen. Ajonatara, you know?
I just wanna say also thank you to Meron. Meron was very, very, very demanding, and then he was saying like, this has to happen. He spent all his money that he's been working for this. And then he's been pushing it. I'm so glad to see that the turnout is very good. So we have to get together. Our focus, we're not politicians. We are focused on education completely, 100%. How we can educate our community, like Melvin says, how do we put our language to the government in office, and we can have access, our people can have access in their own language. So we're focusing on education. Meron had invited every group, religion, politics, youth centers, everybody to come together and work together. So the young generation, like Adam said, we are the only one who can change this. Let's just get together, have email list, work together, no separations, together. So that's the only way we can change it. Because the old generation, like she said, even though some people go over there to pay for the 2% that they charge, they tell them, okay, come tomorrow, because we don't have the paperwork right now. They're changing the tasiera, whatever they're doing right now. Even to fill out for that form is so difficult. For us to advocate for this, education, empowerment, it's all about education, nothing. They told us to pay $100 for vending over there, to vend. It's not a vendor, we're not selling, we're trying to educate our community. But they told us, pay $100. I pay out of my pocket $100 to get in. I was not dancing over there because I'm not happy to dance. It's not dancing time, people are dying. That's what Meron said. My friends, I'm starving because my friends are dying on the way. They're dying. I cannot do anything. I have to put all my energy to this. So we have to get together. Everybody have to sign, work together, no separation, no politics, nothing. Work together. That's the only way we can change it. We have to help our young, our people, everybody. And then my friend Melvin here, he's been helping with the Eritrean community, Ethiopian community, African. Our focus is all African, Black, African, American, Pan-Africa. But we all can do it together. Thank you. What you say was very, very important. Nevia, thank you very much.
Good morning. I'm sorry, but I have to be a bit harsh on you again. It's the second time I see you. You have the energy, you have the ambition, which is all good. But I don't like this generation gaps that some people are trying to create. First of all, it's not a throne that somebody has to say, okay, I'm old, get me up and sit. There's nothing like that. Because the older generation were not created old. They were not born. Okay? Like that. They were young. They had to go through their age. And one day, I take myself as an example. When I joined the struggle, I didn't try to push anybody out of the struggle. I just followed and learned to respect. And when they moved on, other people came. And it's often these people want to work. I have everybody that is trying to that. But trying to make this all as if they are lepers, that I don't accept because it's disrespectful. And the mention of the New York demonstration that you said, 3,000 people, that didn't come from the blue sky. There are people who spent 20 years doing it in 5 people, 6 people, 7 people, growing until you realize that it's 3,000. It didn't stop with 3,000. It was an incremental increase that your fathers or other generations built, and you're working on that achievement. So what I'm trying to say is, let's have some respect. Let's not compartmentalize the type of struggle that we do, because when you're struggling for rights, there is no specification that under 18 should do this, under 20 should do this, under 40 should do this. There is nothing like that. It's a popular movement, it's a popular struggle. Everybody does what they can. So that is creating unnecessary gaps, unnecessary compartmentalization, and then we find unity. With that attitude, I would always get away if I see that attitude. I am old. I never needed the help of anybody. I did it. I still do it. So that shouldn't be counted against me. If you want to come and help me, please do. Please do. I'll give you what I can. I'll teach you what I can. But that respect should be there. Thank you.
I commend exactly, I'm going to say Saleh. I don't see your face, I just read your writing.
Thank you.
That's you, right? I just want to make sure.
Yes, we are.
Okay. So I commend what you said, but I know if she played back the video, I did say, with respect, it's time. And it is time. I do believe that we have to respect our elders, and I do believe we have to work together. But guess what? They also have to work with us. It's a two-way street. And from my experience, especially the last 6 years, that has not been the case. In our culture, we are taught to not so much Eritrean Americans, but Dinenba, right? Like put your head down or stand up if Abeti comes. We do all those things. But right now, we are on a platform that should be equal to everyone. And this platform, especially the Eritrean political platform, hasn't been welcoming to women in a literal sense at all. And it hasn't been welcoming to young people, especially like myself. And I know that might be hard for you guys to swallow, but that is the case. And in order for us to follow, you have to be a good leader. And we haven't seen that. And I'm not gonna just blame the PFDJ side or the opposition side, but in order to be a leader, you must lead, and we will follow. So I respect your feedback, and I, like I said, I don't compartmentalize, and I don't, I'm not divisive, but I'm speaking from my experience. It is time for the new generation, and those are my words. It is time. We have so many educated young, especially Eritreans, coming out of the University of Asmara. Like somebody stated, we have lawyers, doctors, engineers. When are these guys gonna have an opportunity to play a role in our movement? I personally don't wanna be here forever. Behind me now, there's an Elsa Tesfa, there's a Rosanna, there's so many young girls, Saleh, that have joined the movement. Because you know what? I don't wanna be at the top forever. It doesn't work that way. And the same thing with you guys. Behind you, there's a lot of men in this room who we need to know and we need to learn about. It can't always be about Amani Alassana and Jasad Higadi and Ba'al Adiyam and them. It can't be the same names. That's a clique. No, it's a clique. No, I understand. This is my opinion. We have to change that. We have to be open. And that's my perspective as the new generation. Allow us, embrace us, let us in. We're here, we want to work with you. And we want you guys to work with us. And we love you. You're our fathers and you're our mothers. But it is time for us to play a role. It's time for all of these people here, these Menisse here, to play a role. Thank you.
Just a comment. I think I have addressed it gracefully, but I'll disagree with my friend Salah. Just a little, thank you. I agree that it should be compartmentalized slowly. But I think one reality is our generation has not moved the needle one bit. And I think, you know, I like the energy that you guys are coming up. Take on, take charge. So as an older person, that's my comment.
One last question.
That's not a question. My name is Emmanuel. I just moved from Los Angeles, and I'm going to be here for maybe 3 hours. I've seen Alia. I don't expect new things because all has been said. But just to support Miron, I've talked to Miron one day. And I've been, I was the chairman for the Eritrean community for about 4 years and tried to be in the middle of PFDJ and the opposition. And I know the challenges. So on the Nebian's comment, centralization has killed us the last decades, right? So what we need now is decentralization and promoting individuals like Mero, Adia, Almaz, and you know, Blair. So that's what we need right now to undo what has been done. That's the comment. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you. All right. That was a great discussion. So we're gonna go ahead and wrap it up, because I'm pretty sure that folks are pretty hungry right now, right? I know I am. But I do wanna end off with this. So what I did share earlier is that I have 16 years of youth development background. I've been helping young folks for a long time. I may not look like it, but they exposed me at a young age. So at 14, I was placed on the board of directors at my community organization. Back at home. And so So it's real important to really take the time to invest in young people and to educate them young and empower them young so that when they grow older, they're not worried about anyone else being better than them or knocking them out or anything like that. They have the power, they have the courage and the confidence to do what needs to be done. Right? That is so important. But in my work, I was fortunate to come across some pretty strong Eritrean young men and women. And what I can say about them, especially in the midst of the other students that I would have, and I have a diversity of students that I support. You know, those students, they were some of the sharpest, like, well-dressed, you know, they, discipline was real. If people were acting up in our class sessions, they would stop them. You know, when it came to giving, like, cultural presentations, you know, they would communicate with pride about where they come from. And that rubs off on people. For the business that we had, like, they were running the business, right? The entrepreneurial skills were very strong. And so as we're talking about integration and you know, integration, migration, and integration empowerment, you know, Eritreans bring skills, real skills and talents to the table that we need. We desperately need. Like, my young students that I had, like, they really revolutionized that cohort, that classroom. And so I just want to put that out there because, yeah, like, the youth definitely are the future. But it does take the seasoned generation to implant that culture of understanding into the young folks. So you do need both together to make it work because you can't have one without the other. That's just the way that it works. The other day, I was at the Cultural Center, at Alma's Cultural Center, because she does tutoring. And there was a young Eritrean third grade young lady and a young Eritrean fourth grade young male. And I'm telling you what, they are sharp. The young lady, she loves to read. She says she likes complicated books. That means that she doesn't want a book with pictures. She wants real words, right? Yeah, and when it comes to math and competition, she wants to win. The young man's the same thing. He loves math, right? He wants to win. And so just seeing that fire that they have, being like third graders and fourth graders in the educational system, imagine what happens when you cultivate that young, right? You inspire them young. They become phenomenal leaders when they're ready. And so I just wanted to really put that out there and really want to thank everyone, really want to thank our panel for coming here and sharing their stories and their hard work today. Can you all please give it up to the panel? And for the sister in the back that had talked about bringing everyone together to build that organization piece, we have lunch coming up, right? And so what could happen for those folks that really want to get together, start networking and taking everyone's names and addresses down to have that first meeting, today could actually be the first meeting, right? Just choosing a spot in the room and then just building community with each other. So that's a great first start. And so yeah, I'll not jump off here in a second.
Sign me in.
Okay, all right, that's the plan then, thank you. And then I'm getting ready to pass it to Marin, but I really, really want to give it up to Marin. I know you've been hearing your name all day today, but like this brother has really been putting in the grind. I'm talking late night phone calls, text messages, when people talk about him being pushy. Yeah, that is the case. I had no control over what I was going to do today. Melvin, I need you Saturday. Huh? What do you mean? I need you Saturday, I need you to moderate. That was it. That was the end of the discussion. If I had an idea, he's like, no, this is what's going to happen at this time. Yes, sir. Like, that's the situation, right? Marin is an awesome leader. He's a compassionate friend. He handles his business, and he's always, always about the people. And he travels the world. This man right here travels the world to educate the world about issues facing the region. Like, he's really passionate about that. He's willing to put his life out there for it. And I know because I've seen him try. Like, it's crazy. And so, just please give it up to Marin one more time. And I'll pass it on.
Well, we had a wonderful second panel, and I just want to say thank you to all panels and to Melvin. So maybe another round of applause to all partisan moderation. So I founded this organization called Lead Eritrea, where Eritrean youth start leading. It's exactly what Adrian was saying. The youth needs to get up and start doing their part. Not alone, in collaboration with all the generation. There is nothing you can do alone. It's a combination. The hand-in-hand working. The network between the younger generation and the older generation. And if you've seen our panelists, it's a combination of young, old, middle-aged, Eritreans, non-Eritreans, friends of Eritrea. Because we do not live alone here. Yes, we have a country called Eritrea. Maybe 200 years ago, that name didn't exist. Maybe that boundary even didn't exist. Territory didn't exist. So we need to see ourselves as members of this humanity, not just Eritreans. The place we live, the Bay Area, accommodates almost everybody from everywhere around the world. So even when solving our issues, we need to collaborate. Only then we become good about it, making a difference, change. One of the global Millennium Development Goals Eritrea failed is engaging with an outside of governments when it comes to crafting development. And the second one is poverty. So we need to create that. We need to try to bring a good image of our own and to try to collaborate with any world that is doing good in certain areas. So we can always learn and take the good. So Lead Eritrea. Lead Eritrea, we Eritrean youth start leading. Merh Eritrea, Eritrean Manasek Marhulu the Jumuru Baita. How do young people start leading? When they have mentors, when they have people to look up to. Young people like me, when we were back home in Eritrea, we didn't have somebody to look up to. There was until 2001, 2003, everybody was looking at their older generation to get into Asmara University. That was what we were working hard on. Only to find out Asmara University was closed. Only to find out people were getting into prison. Only to find out the route of your life, you go to military training, indefinite national service, and then you become property of the government. And so, Lead Eritrea comes to try to help young people to lead, maybe in diaspora today, but they are the hope for Eritrea. And hence, we do our very best. Lead Eritrea, where Eritrea new start. So, a young man who was born and raised here in the United States designed the logo, and in his own words, he looked at it. You know, Eritreans are right now suffering, leaving their country. But eventually, he says, eventually they will see the light, as you can see on the right-hand side. And they will get back to their country to rebuild this nation. That's how he put this. And he was born and raised here from an immigrant family. What do we try to achieve through Lead Eritrea? To empower and produce leaders, especially the youth. Because This is supposed to be the job of the government. I go to a lot of international events where youth from around the world, young leaders, come forward to share their experience and their work with world leaders. Places like United Nations, One Young World, World Youth Day, a Network of African Youth for Development head office in Addis Ababa on the African Union. And then we try our very best to get Eritrean youth to get involved, to be there in those events, and to not just be there, but to speak on stage. That way, it's an empowerment, it's a leadership. In that way, they would also raise the concern of their people, the issues their country is facing. They become an advocate, they become leaders. They also represent Eritrea at international sanctioned organization, because there is little representation. You go out of here, ask somebody, I'm from Eritrea, and he will say, is that an island in Hawaii? We all get, of course, those questions. And then we work on events like this, which is the first of it. It's time for Lead Eritrea. The idea is to bring everyone, not just opposition, not just supporters, not just government people, not just the diaspora, everybody. When we say everybody, it's not just Eritrean only, also friends of Eritrea, people who have interest in the region. And mostly, you have to bring the people that are doing productive work. Like, there was a great talk here. We need to work in collaboration. We need to create that network of each other and then build a system that would include everybody instead of doing separate stuff. So I hope, if you see the panelists here today, they come from a varying background. They are Eritreans, non-Eritreans, young, old, doing advocacy work, all sorts of work. But they have to come together. Because it's only that way that you build a mountain. So this was from last year at One Young World event. We managed to get the topic migration on stage, and we got Father Monsieur Zorai to introduce the topic. A young, great advocate, Sium is my brother's advocate for prisoners of journalists in Eritrea, especially her uncle and the other journalists, to be released out of prison. It's about 15 years this year, if I'm not mistaken. There was just commemoration going on in their memory in the last 2-3 days. And then a young girl born and raised in the United States. So we try to raise the issues of the country. And this is in 2014, a young girl by the name Luana Stefanos, who spoke remarkably in Ireland. Those previous pictures were in Bangkok. This is in Ireland, Dublin. This is in South Africa, a young man by the name Solomon Haile. And this is at the United Nations Youth Assembly, which there hasn't been another Eritrean going to those places, but we try to go to those events, to represent the country, to be there as Eritreans, raising that recognition of our people. This was in 2012 here in the United States. And not just events like this, but also in collaboration with the African Union, a youth association called Network of African Youth for Development. So we partner with them to share the work we're doing towards the sustainable development goals at the moment. So there's only two dots, as you can see. The one is the work of Lead Eritrea, where Eritrean youth start leading. And the other one is an initiative by a young man who said, education to end poverty and violence. The other African countries have a lot of dots. In Eritrea, we only have two. And conferences like this. What do we want? What do we want out of this? What do we want to achieve? Well, like I said, the most important thing is to bring Eritreans together, regardless of their political. Because this country is diminishing. is disappearing almost. Society is disappearing. The basic family, mother, father, children. Give you an example. I'm here, my older brother is in Canada, younger brother is in South Africa, my mom is in Eritrea. Now that family is spread, not because we want it, but because of that situation maybe. So the basics of development, that whole family does no longer exist in Eritrea. So you can see how much backwards we are moving. When I say to bring all Eritreans together, we know our situation. We are a divided community. We are government supporters, anti-government opposition group, and then there is also the silent. But in that process, even here in Auckland, churches are divided. People are divided. And it's affecting us every day. We can't even come together. Is that the kind of society we need to be? To celebrate what is good in our country and to address real issues facing Eritreans and craft policy towards changing the situation that we face in Eritrea. So I hope from here, we're coming out with policy, we're coming out with solutions. It's not just another conference. We have to engage, we have to come, we have to find a way of working together. And we have the great leaders. You see so many young, amazing, remarkable leaders. Yes, young people must lead, but young people also need to learn. And I always say, young people have also the right to be wrong, but they have the obligation to be corrected. And they have to take it gladly. To familiarize country condition with USA, with this university, hence more Eritrean refugee and asylum will be accepted to study at this institution, and perhaps a scholarship. This event has been spread out everywhere. The president is very supportive. He just had a wedding to attend. The chancellor is very supportive. All the deans have been reached out with this event. Some has contributed. And hopefully, that name Eritrea resonates in their mind when the next time they see an Eritrean applying attend to this institution. And that way, there is a lot of Eritrean refugees and outside in the Bay Area. Hopefully we can have them to push towards getting them accepted here and getting also scholarship. Because it's hard for a refugee to pay the institution's fee. It's a private university, although great university. To state that refugees too are part of the solution to making this world a better place. This by working towards changing country conditions. Usually, refugees are known for as a burden, I guess. I don't think so, they are a burden. In fact, they bring great culture, diversity, food. And this should be a message to the world that refugee doesn't just sit back and let country of condition go on the way it goes on. This event should send a message. We too are part of the solution. We're not just refugee for the name of it. We want to change country condition. We're not here because this is safe haven. If our country was safe enough, we would have been in our country. I never thought of leaving my country. Not to the day that they say this is enough. With that being said, and that is the reason why we're hosting this event today. Those are the objectives that we're trying to achieve. I hope they're meaningful to you. And I want to say thank you for being here today, enjoying this event. And I hope you go out with something. For that, I want to appreciate everybody else. Lunch is going to be served, and we are a little behind our catering company. So how about a little music? But in the meantime, we're also going to have dancers performing Eritrean traditional dance. So it's not just about a conference. It's also about bringing Eritrea here, presenting it we would say, Eritrea is here in San Francisco today. We had traditional stuff displayed. The kids are busy with it because they want to perform with it. But the idea is, it's not just about the conference. It's also about saying the culture was present, the food was present. And as I ran quickly to find out what's happening with the food, just bear with me in mind for a few seconds.